My name is Alexia Rose, and I'm the student body president here at Central Academy of Technology and Arts.
My name is Amy Bell, and I'm the student body president at Monroe High School.
It is a distinct honor to welcome our treasured guests, the students of Monroe High, who are here with us at Central Academy of Technology and Arts for this special occasion. We have a very special guest who will be speaking to us within the hour. The students of Monroe High School and CATA, who are not in the auditorium, will be with us watching the program thanks to the efforts of the Communication and Technology Departments of Union County Public Schools. We ask that everyone pay attention to the important message and lesson we are here for today. Please silence your cell phones and pay close attention.
Before the program today, we heard the song We Shall Overcome, which is a song of the United States Civil Rights Movement. We are here today to hear the story of a group of nine who overcame and to listen intently to one of our nation's civil rights heroes. Many are unaware and indifferent to the flight of African Americans within our country in the past and present. And today we are going to take the time to learn from our nation's history and make the city of Monroe, the state of North Carolina, and the United States and the world a better place for everyone. Please stand for the Pledge of Allegiance and our national anthem, and remain standing until Monroe Academy Color Guard has completely exited off the stage.
Face, freeze that, colors.
We are now going to recite the pledge. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Please continue standing for our national anthem. Everyone, please be seated. We're going to begin today's program by watching video clips to learn about the Little Rock Nine. The first series of video clips are from the PBS series Eyes on the Prize. The second video clip is a reunion of the Little Rock Nine on the Oprah Winfrey Show. Please focus as you have never focused before on these video clips and learn about the group of nine brave African-American teenagers who wanted an equal education. The Little Rock Nine are the first African-American students to enter the all-white Central High School of Little Rock, Arkansas. Federal law of our nation allowed the students to enter, but the governor of Arkansas violated federal law and denied the nine students right to enter the school. President Eisenhower had to send in federal troops to enforce the law of the United States for these nine students. Please watch the story, listen to what the participants have to say, and understand the culture of the time period.
After our video clips, we will get to hear from Ms. Minnie Jean Brown Trickey, who was one of the 9 brave students who overcame the ugliness of racism, who overcame adversity so future students could have a better tomorrow, and so we could live in a nicer and more accepting world. Ms. Brown Trickey stood up for herself and for all of us to have a better future. She served in the administration of former President Bill Clinton and was a recipient of the Congressional Gold Medal, which is one of the highest civilian honors. We are in the presence of an amazing woman and a national treasure. Please watch the videos, then listen to Mrs. Brown Trickey's presentation. Remember, the first video clips tell the story of the Little Rock Nine, and the second video clip is from an experience by the Little Rock Nine on the Oprah Winfrey Show.
It was over a year before the Black community would find its chance to fight back. Here in Little Rock, Arkansas, 1957. Little Rock was a moderate southern city and a moderate southern state. By 1956, both the state universities and the city buses were integrated. Its school board made plans to desegregate slowly. The first year, 1957, 9 Black teenagers would attend one school, Central High. Little Rock's Black leaders were hopeful.
We have a very enlightened group of people in Arkansas. And they have accepted everything else. They accepted bus integration without any fanfare. And they will take the school integration as just another going to school.
The Black children were not getting a chance, and they needed it. They needed it more than anyone, and we were very strongly in favor of that and could see that integration would prove that. But we did, at that stage, have fears, and they were, I guess, just natural inborn emotional fears. And so we needed some help from the officials, the state officials, the county and the city officials, and primarily from Governor Faubus as to what he told the people, whether it was the law or not.
One of the reasons is
Governor Orville Faubus of Arkansas was a moderate by Southern standards, a man the Black community had supported. But in his last election, he'd faced tough opponents, and he knew he'd need the segregationist vote if he wanted to be reelected. The night before school opened, Faubus made a decision.
On an integrated basis,
I have therefore, in accordance with the solemn responsibilities and the oath of my office, taken the following action. Units of the National Guard have been and are now being mobilized with the mission to maintain or restore the peace and good order of this community. Advanced units are already on duty on the grounds of Central High School.
The Arkansas National Guard ringed the school with orders to admit only the white students. It shocked the country. State troops were now being used to prevent enforcement of federal law. At the center of the crisis were these 9 teenagers, selected by the school board because of their excellent grades. The first day, 8 of the 9 went to school together, accompanied by their parents and ministers. They expected some harassment, but no real trouble.
You could cut it with a knife, the tension outside the school, with these people who had come in from other parts of the state, other states. There were license plates from all other states that were there, people who had come in and were outside our school.
The 8 children and the adults with them were turned away by the National Guard. The 9th student, Elizabeth Eckford, had missed the call to gather with the others before school. Elizabeth Eckford walked alone and met a mob.
Oh, Can you tell me your name, please? Are you going to go to school here at Central High? You don't care to say anything, is that right? This girl here was the first Negro, apparently, of high school age. She showed up at Central High School the day that the federal court ordered it integrated. She was followed in front of the school by an angry crowd, many of them shouting epithets at her.
Well, it has to be the most frightening thing. I mean, because she had a crowd of white people behind her threatening to kill her. She had nobody. I mean, there was not a black face in sight anywhere. Nobody that she could turn to as a friend, except that this woman came out of the crowd and guided her through the mob and onto the bus and got her home safely.
The black parents and the NAACP went back to court. The leader of the state organization, Daisy Bates, became the student's strongest supporter. The national NAACP saw this case as a showdown for desegregation, and they assisted the local lawyers.
Well, we consider this case important as one of the segregation cases, but in addition to the fact that this one involved the appearance of the National Guard on the scene, and for the first time in any of our cases, it's the action of the governor that eventually will have to be brought into court.
Then you see it as a state-federal conflict of authority.
Oh, I don't think there's any question about that.
The question was whether the federal government would assert its authority. The pressure on the president increased. Defiance of federal law seemed to be spreading. From Little Rock, here to North Little Rock, to Nashville, Tennessee, and to Charlotte, North Carolina. Some people blamed Eisenhower for this resistance, saying his lack of leadership on civil rights encouraged the extremists.
President Eisenhower's position was that he was the president of all the people. He felt that his role was to talk to the moderates throughout the country, including the southern states. He felt that, and was told by many advisors, that Governor Faubus could be reasoned with and that an amicable solution could be found in the Little Rock crisis.
In mid-September, the president and the governor had a meeting at Eisenhower's vacation home in Newport, Rhode Island.
The president thought that he had persuaded Governor Faubus to go back and allow the black children to enter the high school peaceably. It was quite a surprise to him. He felt let down when Governor Faubus decided against allowing the black children to enter the high school.
Eisenhower had convinced Faubus that ultimately the state could not resist federal authority. Faubus changed his tactic. He simply removed the National Guard, leaving only city police, in an explosive situation as the Little Rock Nine entered Central High School.
We entered the side of the building, thousands of people out front, and we were entering the side, and I could just get a glimpse of this group, and on the car, I could hear, on the car radio, I could hear that there was a mob, and I knew what a mob meant. And I knew that the sounds that came through the crowd were very angry. So we entered the side of the building very, very fast.
Well, we've just got a report here on this end that the students are in. They're trying to turn the people down that way.
Down there. You can see from here some of the action occurring down there.
The three of us represented the black press. That was all, and we were on the mall in front of the school, And the word got to the crowd outside that the niggas are in the school. Then they said to us, you come out here as a decoy, and then other people slipping into the side of this building. So I said, hell no, like that, you see.
The crowd turned on Hicks and on his companions, Moses Newsom and Alex Wilson.
Somebody had a brick in his hand, and instead of throwing the brick, because he was too close, he hit Alex Wilson up beside his head with this brick. Of course, Wilson was more than 6 feet tall, an ex-Marine. He went down like a tree.
The mob was getting past the wooden sawhorses because the policemen would no longer fight their own in order to keep to protect us. And so someone made a suggestion that if they allowed the mob to hang one kid, they could then get the rest out. And a gentleman, whom I believe to be an assistant chief of police, said, how are you going to choose? You're going to let them draw straws. He said, I'll get them out. And we were taken to the basement of this place. And we were put into two cars, grayish, blue-colored Fords. And the man instructed them. He said, once you start driving, do not stop.
The rioting was headline news. The nation and the world saw unmistakably the face of resistance. Finally, President Eisenhower realized he had to act, and he did quickly. That night, he sent in the paratroopers of the 101st Airborne Division.
An extreme situation has been created in Little Rock. This challenge must be met, and with such measures as will preserve to the people as a whole their lawfully protected rights. If resistance to the federal court order ceases at once, the further presence of federal troops will be unnecessary and a blot upon the fair name and high honor of our nation in the world will be removed. Mob rule cannot be allowed to override the decisions of our courts.
My fellow citizens, we are now an occupied territory. In the name of God, whom we all revere, in the name of liberty we hold so dear, in the name of decency which we all cherish, what is happening in America?
We got into the Jeep, into the station wagon, rather, and the convoy that went from Mrs. Bates' house to the school that had a Jeep in front, a Jeep behind. They both had machine gun mounts, and then the whole school was ringing with paratroopers and helicopters hovering around, and we marched up the steps with this circle of soldiers with bayonets drawn. I figured that we had really we had really gone into school that day, and walking up the steps that day was probably one of the biggest feelings I've ever had. I figured I had finally cracked it.
And there was a feeling of pride and hope that, yes, this is the United States. Yes, there is a reason I salute the flag. And it's going to be okay. You know, if these guys just go with us the first time, it's going to be okay. The troops did not, however, mean the end of harassment. It meant the declaration of war.
Tell your mama, tell your pa, I'm gonna send you back to Arkansas. Oh, yeah.
It was the beginning of a school year like no other at Little Rock Central High.
When we got in the school, they then assigned us an individual soldier to walk us from class to class. He waited outside the classroom, and every time the bell rang and classes changed, he would walk us. We'd have our own personal guide walking us to the next class.
The troops were wonderful. If, you know, there was some fear that they were dating the girls in high school. And I don't care what they were doing. They were wonderful. But they couldn't be with us everywhere. They couldn't be with us, for example, in the ladies' bathroom. It couldn't be with a gym. You'd be walking out to the volleyball court and someone would break a bottle and trip you on the ball. I have scars on my right knee from that.
Of course, we couldn't have a normal school, but we had to have as close to normal as possible. And you couldn't follow every student around with a guard into the, you know, the stories were that the male guards were going to the restrooms with the female black students, and you couldn't do things like that. And you couldn't sit with them at the cafeteria. There wouldn't be any integration if you did that. So I'm proud of what we did and what we didn't do.
Would you think you could get used to going to school with colored children?
Yes, sir, I think so. I mean, if I'm gonna have to do it, I might as well get used to it.
Well, now, what about this? Do you think that the trouble is with the students here in the high school and in the schools of Little Rock, or is it with the parents, or is it with outsiders, or where is the trouble?
I think it's the parents. I mean, I saw, you know, all these crowds out here, men kicking that Negro and everything.
And you don't sympathize with that sort of action at all?
No, sir, I don't.
What do you think?
Well, I think it was just downright un-American. I think it was the most terrible thing that has ever been seen in America. I mean, yeah, I guess I'm sounding patriotic or something like that, but I always thought that all men were created equal.
And I began to change from being somebody who considered myself a moderate who, if I had my way, would have said, let's don't integrate because it's the state's right to decide, to someone who felt a real sense of compassion for these students and felt like they deserved something that I had, and also developed a real dislike for the people that were out there that were causing the problems. It was very unsettling to me.
I never had anything to do with any until we came here. I mean, we just never lived, well, what you'd say, close enough to us, or we just never were around them, really.
Isn't that part of what makes it difficult when you live 15 or 17 years of your life and then start doing something different all of a sudden?
Well, I think, like, if a Spanish or a Chinese person came here, it wouldn't be hard to get along with them. It's just that the Negroes are, what you might say, more different to us than a Spanish person might be.
It's early morning here at 1121 Cross Street in Little Rock, and a new school day is dawning.
Melba!
Yes, Mother?
You better hurry. You're going to be late for school.
Here I come.
As usual, the girl in the family is running a little late. The girl is Melba Patillo, 15 years old.
You know, I worry about silly things like keeping my saddle shoes straight. What am I going to wear today? The things that a 15-year-old girl does worry about. You know, but also, which part of the hall to walk in that's the safest? Who's going to hit me with what? Is it going to be hot soup today? Is it going to be so greasy that it ruins the dress my grandmother made for me? I mean, how's this day going to go? And then, you know, you get out and you get to the car, and then we joke. We kind of play with each other. And your stomach would go back into its seat. But then again, we'd get to the head of the NAACP, Daisy Bates' house, and we'd have to face press conference.
Ms. Bates, how do you feel with your work, both with the school authorities, with the city authorities, and with the military authorities, that the situation is developing now?
Very well. The military authorities have been very nice to the children, as well as the school board and the state police.
By Thanksgiving, the Little Rock Nine had become seasoned veterans, giving sophisticated statements to the press at a dinner held by Mr. and Mrs. Bates.
My name is Gloria Ray. I am thankful for having a chance to fulfill my educational desires and for being a citizen in a country where the federal government respects and protects the rights of all its people.
My name is Terrence Roberts, and I'm in 78 Venice. And I would like to say that I know that communists enjoy taking advantage of situations such as these to twist the minds of peoples of the world. But I'm thankful that in America, their actions are being foiled through the efforts of many democratic-minded citizens.
I'm Minnie Jean Brown. I'm thankful for the many people who have stood by us and worked diligently in our struggle for a perfect democracy.
At school, the black teenagers were still being harassed by a few determined whites. Shortly before Christmas, Minnie Jean Brown struck back.
For
or a couple of weeks, there had been a number of white kids following us. A series of hassles, continuous calling us niggers, nigger, one right after the other. And Minnie Jean Brown was in the lunch line with me. And that was this, I was in front of Minnie. Minnie was behind me, and there was this white kid, fella, who was much shorter than Minnie. Minnie was about 5'10". And this fella couldn't have been more than 5'4". And he reminded me of a small dog yelping at somebody's leg. Minnie had just picked up a chili.
I could just see her little head click. She consciously said to herself, "No, Minnie Jean, if you do this, you know you won't be here." But then this was the time of the year when we all didn't want to be there.
And before I could even say, you know, "Minnie, why don't you tell him to shut up?" Minnie had taken this chili, dumped it on this dude's head. It was just absolute silence in the place. And then the help, all black, broke into applause. And the other white kids there didn't know what to do. I mean, it was the first time that anybody, I'm sure, had seen somebody black retaliate in that sense.
When Minnie Jean was kicked out of school following the chili incident, maybe 15, 20 students brought cards and gave them out that said, "One down, eight to go." When school was out in May, they still hadn't given up the fight. They came out with a two-color card that said, "Ike, go home, Liberation Day, May 29th, 1958, which was graduation day. They were still fighting the battle even then.
On May 29th, 1958, Central High School prepared to graduate 601 white students and Ernest Green.
We still didn't know whether some outsiders might roll in from some other states and firebomb the place. So we were a little nervous about it, as was Ernest, and he stood around, joked with the students. We were all joking together there waiting to process in. And I do remember that as the students' names are called and they get up and go across the platform and receive their diploma, that I really held my breath when Ernest's name was called.
There were a lot of claps for the students. You know, they talked about who had received scholarships, who was an honor student and all that, as they called the names up. When they called my name, it was nothing, just the name. And there was this eerie silence. Nobody clapped. But I figured they didn't have to, because after I got that diploma, that was it. I had accomplished what I had come there for.
I'm so glad I'm fighting for my rights. I'm so glad I'm fighting for my rights. I'm so glad I'm fighting for my rights. Glory, hallelujah.
Ernest, what's it been like this year? It's been what you expected, or?
Well, from the beginning, it wasn't quite what we expected, but adding all things together and putting all sides together, I think it's turned out to be, I would say an interesting year. I guess that would be an understatement, but when you put all the sides together, we've had some nice times as well as some rough times, and I think all in all, it's worked out rather nicely.
By the time school had ended, I had sort of settled into myself, and I could have gone on for the next 5 years. It didn't matter anymore. I was past feeling. I was into just that kind of numb pain where you say, "Hey, I can make it, do whatever you'd like, and it just doesn't matter anymore." But I came home, and by myself, I walked to the backyard, and I burned my books. I burned everything that I could burn. And I just stood there crying, looking into the fire, and wondering whether I would go back, but not wanting to go back.
Melba Patillo didn't have to face that decision. The next year, Governor Faubus closed down all Little Rock's high schools to halt integration. Faubus was so popular that year, he easily won his third term as governor.
Joining me now are three of the white students who admit in one form or another to being part of that ugliness in Little Rock. This is Ann Bolton as she appeared in 1957. She was chanting the words 2468, we don't want to integrate. And Ann says she is now ashamed of that schoolyard chant. Jean Porter regrets being a silent witness to the crimes by fellow white students, including seeing them put thumbtacks on Melba's chair, and also witnessing boys in gym urinating on the lockers of Ernest Green. And David Sontag came here today, he says, to apologize to Minnie Jean for an altercation in the cafeteria. What happened?
Oh, I went in the cafeteria and I'd sort of been dared by other kids, you know, to retaliate for Minnie Jean for having poured chili on someone's head earlier. And so I did it. But it was not done out of hate.
What was it done out of?
It was done out of ignorance. Mm-hmm. Of not understanding her plight. Mm-hmm. And the plight of all of them. We didn't really know. We weren't walking in their shoes. We didn't put ourselves in their shoes. And I know that I didn't treat them the way I would have wanted to be treated.
How did you treat them?
I don't necessarily remember being ugly, straightforward to any of them individually, but just being a part of a group that would, you know, chant and say negative things.
Mm-hmm. Are you the reason Minnie Jean was expelled?
I may be part of the reason.
Uh-huh. So you came here today, what?
I am genuinely sorry for any negative things that I did at that time. I was really acting as a child that was not prepared.
Mm-hmm. And you are now here because you were ashamed.
Yes, I am. Mm-hmm. I knew Carlotta just because she had a locker close to me, and we would, you know.
And that's how I recognized you off the bat. I remember you. I remember your smile. I remember your eyes. I remember your catcalls. You used to get me coming out of English class, walking down the hall. You remember that? And I've never forgotten your name. I've never forgotten your name. Never, ever.
Was he not nice to you?
He was insidious because he was continuous. He was like relentless.
Does his apology mean anything to you?
I would like to come forward.
A lot.
Apologize,
sure. Yeah, it means a lot to us.
I want to get out here. Oh.
Don't worry about it.
I wish you all the good.
Yeah, thanks, dear.
And you better listen than you.
Well, this is why our show was absolutely groundbreaking and, you know, as far as I'm concerned, defined itself as a cultural icon. The show did. In our ability to reach not only just the pinnacle of the story, to tell the story, but to also reach for reconciliation and peace. How do we show people how to make peace? And how they can also be peace. That is what that show did. Because when you see the Little Rock Nine, courageous as they are, it took an enormous amount of courage for the people who had done the spitting to come on national television on a show hosted by an African-American woman, and to face them and say, I'm sorry.
Now, the moment we have all been waiting for, Miss Minnie Jean Brown Turkey will now speak to us.
Mama. Mama High School and Central Academy, please stand and give a warm welcome and round of applause for Miss Minnie Jean Brown Turkey.
Thank you very much. I wish I could see you, but I did see you
when I came in. Thank you for coming. This is my favorite audience. Maybe fifth grade is my favorite, so if you can all just return to the fifth grade, we'll be fine. I have a hard time watching both those shows. And first, I want to thank Mr. Wall and Ms. Fizen, I hope I said it right, for coming to get me at a late hour last night. We had a good time talking, and I was warmly welcomed, as I've been, by everyone. So I don't want to spend a lot of time talking, because just talking at you. I really like the whole question and answer thing. I really get revved up when we're having a conversation. So I'm going to try to, you kind of know the story. Let me see if I can correct some things for you. Elizabeth Eckford, the girl who was, quote, separated from us, that's what they say. There's a poem by Cyrus, she's a girl who got mobbed, and they say she was separated from us. But that's crazy. That's analyzing from the back. We're going to school. She took the bus, got off the bus to go to school. So this poem, it's called Soul Make a Path Through Shouting by Cyrus Castells. Soul Make a Path Through Shouting for Elizabeth Eckford, Little Rock, Arkansas, 1957. Thick at the school gate are the ones rage has twisted into minotaurs, harpies, relentlessly swift. So you must walk past the pincers, the swaying horns, sister, sister, straight through the gusts of fear and fury, straight through. Where are you going? Here we go to meet the hydra-headed day. Here we go to meet the maelstrom. Can my voice be an angel on the spot, an amen corner? Can my voice take you there, gallant girl, with a notebook up, up from the shadows of gallows trees to the other shore, a globe bathed in light, a chalkboard blooming with equations. I've never seen the likes of you, pioneer in dark glasses. You won't show the mob your eyes, but I know your gaze, steady on the North Star burning with their jerry-rigged faith, their spear of the American flag. How could they dare to believe you're someone sacred? Burr-headed girl, where are you going? I'm just going to school. So we have in the Little Rock desegregation crisis, to me, the pure definition of profound intentional ignorance, that those people, whoever they were, that mob was willing to expose themselves to the world, because let me tell you, it was to the world. Their hatred, their ignorance, and yes, they lie when they say they were all from out of town. They were not. They lie when they say they've never had exposure to Black people. As you well know, here in the South, that's not true. We have these many ways of interacting with each other. So in terms of the Little Rock, why is it an important story? Yeah, we have the footage and it's cool and I was so gorgeous and I really like that. And I go to my kids, yeah, your mom was the bomb and all that. And so it's really kind of cool to have that, but it's hard to watch because in fact, that's a surfacey story. It kind of just goes really smooth. As I was telling Mr. Wall on the way about the graduation of Ernest, that there were so many death threats that there were sharpshooters all over the, whatever they call it, field house, because then they tried to get him not to march because people wanted to kill him, okay? And people wanted to kill us. And they threatened us every day that they were going to kill us. And they tried to kill our spirits. And they tried to kill our persistence. But guess what? I'm still here and I'm still crazy, okay? Thank you, Central High School. The whole, what are the stories at Central? They're the quintessential United States history. 14th Amendment, Constitution, federal courts, governors opposing federal law, mob violence. The cool thing that Oprah kind of dealt with, silent witnesses, those people who stood by and said nothing. 2,000 white kids, 9 black kids. By the way, the school board didn't select us. We selected ourselves. So part of the story of Little Rock is about teenagers taking seriously their social responsibility. If it's wrong, you have to change it. You cannot let things stay as they are. You know what? We got the raggedy old books from the white schools and the black schools. And they were so old, they were still saying the world was flat. Okay, excuse me. And is that not intentionally trying not to allow kids to be educated? If you have situations where you feel that you're not getting what you should from the institutions of learning, make them change. That's your social responsibility. That's your capability. We were 14 and 15 when we signed up to go to Central. Now they say they selected us, but I say I selected myself. But that's how history gets told. It's kind of hard to affirm that teenagers made decisions on their own and had to sort of help the older people come to terms with them. And you may have some of that in your state. I wanted to ask you, I like to do quizzes. Does anybody in here know who Dorothy Counts is? Well, I'm not gonna accuse you of profound intentional ignorance, but okay. Dorothy Counts, and she was a role model for me. Dorothy Counts was one of the first black students admitted to, oh my God, I just lost it, come on. Anyway, in Charlotte, excuse me, how far is that? Is it on the other side of the world? What? I saw her pictures. So check her out. You can Google Dorothy Counts and she'll come up for you. Dorothy Counts was one of the first black students admitted to the Henry Harding High School in Charlotte, North Carolina. After 4 days of harassment that threatened her safety, her parents forced her to withdraw from the school. So she was on September 4th, and I saw her picture, and I was inspired. And I thought, if she can do it, I can do it. And I'm sure she saw our pictures and said, if they can do it, I can do it. So, just want you to know that you have to know what goes on in the world in order to be a critically thinking person. And if you don't know what happens in your own state, I'm sorry for you. I can walk down the streets in Belfast, Northern Ireland, and kids will know who I am. They have units on the Little Rock desegregation crisis in the Cape Town, South African district schools, because they teach their kids about apartheid based on American apartheid, because their kids are like our kids. They didn't think they experienced it. And so there have to be ways to help them understand. And Little Rock is how they help South African kids to understand apartheid. Part of the reason that different scholars say that if you're in a room with two different Eisenhower scholars, they tend to have opposite views. Some say Eisenhower called out the 101st Airborne to protect us because of the goodness of his heart. Forget goodness of his heart. I don't need goodness of heart. Just do what the legislation says. The other scholar says that he called out the 101st because the world was watching, and there we were talking about democracy around the world and didn't have it here. So he was forced. It doesn't matter why people do things. He had to do it because we kept going back. And this is the understanding that you have to have. No government operates without pressure. No school system, no administration. People have to be persuaded. And the president wouldn't have called out the 101st Airborne if we hadn't kept going back. And so that idea of persistence of the human spirit is totally present in this story. There are hundreds of books about Little Rock. I get so many emails from kids doing History Day projects. It's a beautiful story in all its horror. Writer James Baldwin says, our history is more beautiful and more terrible than we know. And that certainly fits Little Rock. And I was asked this morning a really good question, which, what is the most important thing that I got from that experience? And I think it was compassion. I think Little Rock desegregation and the terror, and that's what it's called. There's no soft word for what happened to us. I would love to say harassment, but that doesn't cut it, okay? That within that, it taught me compassion. I felt sorry for them, because they didn't seem capable of thought. Now, that's not what we're taught in this country. We have a real thing about white supremacy, black inferiority, and that kind of thing continues to work on us and what we believe and what we think. But honestly, I felt really sorry for them, because they were hurting me every day. Physically, psychologically, economically, because it caused my father to lose his business. But I kept going. And you know what? When you have a concept that you're superior to somebody, and somebody like me comes along, you're messed up, okay? Because I was confident. I have a description of myself. Tall, beautiful, and proud. And we're trained that I wasn't supposed to have those qualities. that I was to be grateful to be in Central. I was not grateful. It was my right, and I was taking my right. And in fact, to do. Frederick Douglass says, power concedes nothing. So there's so many phrases about the struggles, the various struggles that help us. Elie Wiesel, who kind of coined the concept silent witness, and I'll explain. 2,000 white kids, 20 nice kids, 100 bad kids, and 1,900 kids who stood by and said nothing. And Elie Wiesel, Holocaust survivor, says, when you are silent, who do you think you support? He also says, sometimes the greatest problem is the people who remain indifferent. So I work with lots of high school students. I spent lots of time thinking about trying to respond to the idea of bullying, because Little Rock is the definitive bullying story, how to respond to it, what we do. I picked up in that, you know, somebody needs to put a hook, because I get so excited when I'm talking that I can't be shut down. But I was in the near the office, and you have questionnaire for being bullied. And then I found out that it's a state initiative. So you don't have to raise your hand, but I can go into a room and ask how many people have been bullied, whether cyber bullied or whatever kind of bullying. Don't put your hands up. I don't want you. And about 80% of people have. So what the, I almost said hell, but I who are we? What are we? What kind of monsters are we that people respond to that question saying, yes, they've been bullied? Yeah, that they thought they had an excuse in 1957. They thought they owned the school and that I shouldn't be there. So that was a good excuse. What's the excuse now? So what a lot of what I do is anti-bullying work. So I'd really like to let the wild rumpus start, if any of you are familiar with where the wild things are. Are you? Not the movie, the book. Oh, thank you. Oh my God. So, you know, let the wild rumpus start. We're going to do questions. I got a mic that allows me to walk around. Somebody is going to, I'm going to move in front of the lights so I can see you. And let's go with this. Let's have a conversation. Anything you wanted to know, don't be afraid to ask. I have 6 kids. I lose a lot of arguments. I'm willing to lose a few here. Let's get going. Tech, 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 tech. Okay, let's see if this one's working. See if it'll go down. Okay.
Can Diane Ramirez from Monroe High School come to the mic, please? Oh, you come to this side.
Wow, that's a long walk to come.
Can Max Hockenberry from CADA please come up also?
My question is, what did the other students react during the interrogation? What did the other students react during the interrogation?
What kind of, in terms of, give me a little more about what you want to know.
Like, how did the other students react when you guys were there?
You mean white students?
Yeah.
Toward the black students?
Yes.
Yeah, we got to use these words. They're very important because that's what it was about. Well, I'm going to use the word hell again, okay, with a great deal of emphasis. A couple of, like, an assembly, well, we're always bruised, big bruises, because if you come to an assembly, if kids come down the hall, you can't tell who's kicking you, although you kind of know. And the boys wore Elvis Presley haircuts and tap shoes. I don't know if you've ever seen those. Anybody seen tap shoes with the big heavy? A lot of boys wore those, so we had our bruises were pretty bad, and they were forever. And body slams, I'm sure they had to change the lockers at Central because our body shapes must have been in all the lockers. Breaking glass on the floor of the gym and filling it with steam. I don't know who taught the girls to manage to have only the hot water running when we were taking a shower. Somebody helped them. And all those cards, they weren't printed on computers. Somebody had to have a print shop. So it was horrific. And it was really bad at home because of the threats. And one of the things that happened to my mother is somebody called, I mean, they used to do it all the time, but you're not sure, but the first time you get the call and say, we have a girl in the morgue who we think is your daughter, can you come down and identify her? So they were very sophisticated. I wish people would use that kind of sophistication in learning rather than in violence. That's my wish. So thanks for that question.
You're welcome.
Can Dip Petraski from Aroha come to the mic?
So how did your perspective on America change after being treated so poorly by the students of Central High?
I think you can probably imagine it was pretty bad. My heart was broken on the first day because I'd been good and knew all the songs and put my hands in all the right places. And I mean, I'm so old that the Pledge of Allegiance didn't even have Under God in it, okay? So imagine even living in a segregated society, we are brainwashed equally to believe that we have liberty and justice for all, even when you don't have it. Even when I couldn't go to the movies downtown, and I could sit in the balcony in the couple of theaters where I could, and even though I sat on the back of the bus, and the great American dream, which you don't have anymore, was to go to a soda fountain and have a Coke. No, couldn't do that. Couldn't sit on those round stools. Couldn't go into a pharmacy and have. Didn't see myself reflected. Even under those circumstances, I still believed. Because that's how brainwashing works, even in the poorest, most horrible. I can see a street person sleeping on a grate And he will say, oh yeah, I live in the best country in the world. And I'm saying, okay, if you say so. I don't want anybody's heart to be broken like that. That's why I come and talk. That's why I work with kids, because I don't want our hearts to be broken like that. I teach nonviolence. I teach social change. I work with young people because I don't want your heart broken. You shouldn't have to have your heart broken in that way.
Can I please have LaMonica Wall from Central Academy?
How did you prepare for school?
Oh, how did I prepare?
Yeah.
To say, oh, they don't want me there. I'm going anyway. I mean, you know, it's the ultimate nonviolence. Don't get mad, just get up and go. I'm trying to write my memoir. There are no words to describe what it was. But I mean, I try to put it in a way like, you don't want me there, I'm coming. And we have to tell ourselves different things to do hard things. And it's kind of fun coming up with good ideas. And my mother would say, would you like to take, she didn't say this, would you like to take a mental health break? And I say, no, I've got to go see what they're going to do to me today. Okay, so how we make unpleasant things palatable is strange and weird and probably sick, you know, the idea that I would say I'm going so I can see what they're going to do. But also, it's about a basic defiance. This is my right. You want to be stupid? I'm not going to be. And, you know, we're taught in the United States that that white people are superior to black people. Well, hey, I threw that one out the first day. I tried to go in Central and said, you're superior to me? You have got to be kidding. So I mean, you can use all kinds of really diabolical ways to survive difficult situations. And anything goes, right? I'm going to tell you one thing. We used to get these body slams against the lockers. So you walk close to the walls so they can only slam you so far. And Elizabeth and her sister were both seamstresses, so they put straight pins in their binders so that when the body slam came, they might have received maybe a pin prick. We call that creative nonviolence, okay? So yeah, you think of ways, but you're still behaving in a manner. It takes a lot of whatever, fortitude and guts to do that. But we all have that. And that's the key. That's another one of my things. We all have it. It's there. When the rod of steel needs to come up, it comes. It's right there. Thanks for that question.
Thank you.
Can I get Katora Hickman from our high school?
What made you want to go to Central High, even though you knew that they were going to harass you? Because back then, during that period of time, they didn't like black people. So what pushed you to make that decision?
Has anything changed in the current context? Really? Okay. As long as we got that straight, right? Because it was there, okay? Central High School was the most beautiful high school in America, built at great expense. It was 11 blocks
from my house. And the Supreme Court had ruled that segregation in public schools was unconstitutional. The 14th Amendment said equal protection under the law. It was there. And that's how we have to see it. We have to see that it's there for us. Yeah, they built two schools, a black school in the Far East, a white school in the Far West, so that there couldn't, it was designed to fail. As we're still doing that, we're still designing things to fail. So please, I seriously, on the day that it came on the intercom, if you live in the Central District and you want to go, sign this piece of paper. It turns out that Elizabeth Eckford, Melville Patillo, Thelma Mothershed, and I were in the same homeroom, and we all said, oh, we're going to sign up. You have to understand, one, that sometimes you do stuff, and guess what? It makes history. And I'm kind of glad that I did sign up. And because it was there.
Can Hannah Register from CADA please come down?
I wanted to know, did you get the same opportunities as the white students did?
Obviously not. They were kicking the shit out of us. Is that real enough? Yes, no. No. The teachers were horrible. They wouldn't, well, we each, okay, here's what. We can, in the world, we can never expect that everybody will be on our side or believe what we believe. But sometimes it's one person who makes all the difference. And each of us had one teacher who wouldn't let them mess with us in the classroom. And, so that was a safe, but I mean, who's funny? Somebody's collecting money for something and they won't take it from your hand. You have to put it on the desk and then they like act like it's poison. Or in my French class, oh my God, there is nothing worse than French with a Southern accent, okay? Anyway. She let them do anything. So when you're walking in the class, all the boys put their legs across the aisle. What are you supposed to do? Okay, you go to another row. So then they put theirs there. So what do? And she can't see anything. So we're all trained this. This is about training. This is not about anything natural or inherent. Or any of those. These people, we are trained to believe what we believe because it's ideology, process. And so to support that ideology, we have to make laws. And so all the laws, like Supreme Court, the Dred Scott decision many years ago, the judge said, blacks weren't supposed to be citizens. They weren't included in this. We had no intention of them to be included in this. So here our belief system comes from stuff they did 300 years ago. And that's what I mean about if we don't know that, then we can't change it. Because I hear people say all the time, well, why, it's just God's will. No, I don't know who your God is, but it ain't my God's will, okay? I hear people talk about things. The biggest word
in Little Rock and during the desegregation era was that integration was an abomination against God. Excuse me, have you heard this recently? Well, then you're under a big tent of ignorance, because that is a common phrase used whenever people want rights that we don't want them to have. We just throw in God and say, and unilaterally decide that it's an abomination against God. So, yeah.
Thank you.
Can I get Naja Armstrong?
Hi.
Hi.
Was there ever a time that you felt defeated or like you wanted to give up, or did that experience kind of like drive the passion and hunger for change that you have now?
That is a great question. It's actually both. And I think we can have both feelings. We can simultaneously be despondent and discouraged. We can, and then have that other feeling that I can't let it stop me. So it's both. And that's a great question, because I think we have to acknowledge that, you know, I say, oh, we are so brave and all that. We weren't. We weren't. There was nothing that could have prepared us for that. And so it went from one day, oh, I can't do this, to I'm going to do this. So it's both. And it's my understanding. My daughter is a playwright, and she wrote a play called One Night. And she had she actually talked a lot to my mother. My mother and I never really talked about what was happening at Central. I think it was too hard for us, but she talked to my daughter. And my mother said on one day she would say to my dad, she's got to come out, I can't take it. And he would say, okay, had a really deep voice, okay, one more day. And then the next day my dad would say, I can't stand this, she's got to go, we've got to take her out. And she would say, oh, you know, she's pretty good, just one more day. So I mean, I wish I could give a recipe, but I can't, because it's both. It's both despondency and whatever that word, courage or craziness, whichever way you want to call it, right? And, but we have to operate with those, and we have to know that we have both. And they're good. They both help us.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Morgan Medlock from CATA.
I have to say, these are great questions.
My question would be, how long did it take for the school to accept you?
Well, I got expelled, okay. It never did accept me. And then, yeah, the governor closed the schools. Well, actually, you know, everybody blames the governor, but the state legislature closed the schools the next year, all the high schools. So, but hey, they did that in Virginia for 5 years, probably in North Carolina. I don't know. I'll have to read North Carolina history, which may or may not be present. But there are really ways that people use to, I can't tell you how. You know, they didn't spend a lot of time on that mob thing, but did you see those women pushing down the horses that were going to come in that school and kill us, okay? That was their intent. So we're not talking about just making noise. We're talking people with definite intent.
So who do you have to be to feel that strongly about 9 kids in your school of 2000? Who do you have to be? What kind of mind do you have to have? Profound, intentional ignorance. You know what? Those same women were going home and some black woman was taking care of her baby. But she did not think that that same woman's child could go to school with her kids. That's called craziness, okay? I forgot the question.
How long did it take for your school to accept you?
It didn't. They didn't. Imagine a society that will close its schools to avoid desegregation. Like if we're overriding them, coming in teeming hordes. There were only 9 of us. Well, I mean, 20 kids they were going to allow. And on the first day, 9 appeared. And this stuff didn't rub off. I didn't notice anybody turning brown after I went in that school. Thank you for that.
Thank you.
Can Olivia Roman from Monroe High School.
Okay, so how did it feel to be escorted by soldiers to all of your classes?
Safe. That was it. Because they dispersed the mob. The mob had ill intent. That was the whole purpose. The president sent the 101st to protect us because there was ill intent and violence. And the man who was beaten in this thing, Alex Wilson, died 2 years, got Parkinson's disease and died. Nobody got arrested for those attacks. He was a Marine. You know, I on my way here, I was reading this Du Bois, intellectual, W.E.B. Du Bois. It's called The Gift of Black Folk. And he's talking about in the wars that we've had, which apparently have gone on for forever, we have so many, blacks have participated. Actually, blacks fought against the Patriots with the British. There's a show coming called I don't know what they call it in the US. Oh, they call it The Book of Negroes. It's written by a Canadian author. It's coming here, Black History Month. And it talks about partly blacks who went to Nova Scotia as part of United Empire Loyalists. Anybody heard of them? I doubt it. Nope, we don't talk about that. And so blacks actually went to Nova Scotia. So there are people in Nova Scotia, hierarchy of arrival dates that we love so much, who are 12 generation United Empire Loyalists in Nova Scotia. So there's lots to know and we have to keep learning. There's a movie called Selma. Anybody heard of that? Can you raise your hands? Anybody go? What? Oh, good. Thank you. You passed, okay? Thank you. Okay, say that question again. Let's see if I can come back to it.
How did it feel to be escorted by soldiers to all of your classes?
Oh, and the answer is safe. And that's a good answer. But what happened is President Eisenhower, once the mob was dispersed in October, the 101st were gone. And so we were protected.
by the Arkansas National Guard, the same people who had been ordered to block us. And they did an okay job. And the funny thing about both groups of soldiers was they were no more than a couple of years older than we were. And that was another learning experience. We like to send our young out to die in different places under different circumstances, because they were all like 17 and 18. They were us. We were fighting one battle. They were going to fight another one. Pretty scary.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Liette Bell.
This is pretty organized. This is great.
What were people saying when, like, you walked in, like a threat? Like, I know it must be pretty bad. So,
I think you can guess. Yeah. My most unfavorite word was the main one, and ugly, black, you stink. Go back to Africa. Excuse me, 1610. You go back to wherever the hell you came from. I mean, what kind of weird thing does it take for somebody to say, go back to Africa, for God? I mean, there's this reporter for the Clarion Ledger in Jackson, Mississippi, and he was responsible for helping people who did murders in different parts of the South to get convicted. And so Byron D. LeBeckwith, who killed somebody, I think maybe Medgar Evers, said, if you write bad stories about me, you won't go to hell, you'll go to Africa. And Jerry Mitchell said, oh my God, I've always wanted to go to Africa. So, I mean, if they were going to pay my way, I would have gone, you know. The N-word, which I am totally, like, practically lose my nonviolence when I hear it, because that's a perfect example of profound intentional ignorance, to use a word that has so much hatred and degradation and denigration in it, and to use it by anyone, even those people say, oh, we made it into an affectionate. Well, excuse me, make water into wine and straw into gold. Don't be talking about making a word into an affectionate, because you can't. And so it's that word. Anyway, I hate it, and I challenge anybody around me who says it. I don't care who they are. I actually challenged these young men in the airport, and they looked at me like I was crazy. And I said, no, you cannot use that word in my presence, whether it be a public place or a private place, because you don't know what it means. And if you did, you wouldn't.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Can I get Jaslyn Santos from our high school?
How does it feel to have helped pave the way for the way Central High is today and for the way the country is?
Well, I just have, when I see those kids who are, I have great admiration for them. And the older I get, the more admiration I have for them, who are the little ones. And on the state capitol grounds, there are statues of the Little Rock Nine. I don't think it gets any better than having a statue when you are alive. And they aren't on pedestals, they're on the ground. And the artists, male and female artists who created them on the ground. And so you see kids, when I would drive by, you'd see kids with their arms linked in the arms, and then they put Santa hats and teddy bears in the arms, but the state said that's vandalism, so they took them down. But it's pretty cool. And it's cool because, I mean, and also my woman activism, my environment, you know, I've been arrested for sitting in and all that, plus saving old growth trees. So I have a criminal record. I am a convicted tree hugger. And I am a convicted civil rights sit-inner. And a couple of times when I've gotten jobs, they say, well, you can't get a job with this record. And I say, okay, let's check it out. And it's usually something like, when people find out civil rights arrest, well, John Lewis, who's the congressman, was put in jail for 40 times. Excuse me, I only have like 3 or 4. So, oh, I'm such a weakling. But yeah, there's a Little Rock Central High School National Historic Site is quite amazing. It's a unit of the National Park Service. Central High is the only working high school that is a historic site. And thank goodness that it's right now in the Black neighborhood, and it would have probably decayed and rotted, but because it's a National Historic Site, it's been preserved and taken care of. So, woo-hoo, thank goodness. But then some people say, and they've said it to me, the worst thing that ever happened to us was integration. And I said, well, when it comes, let me know. Because we still really value segregation. You know, we have housing segregation. We don't realize that was structured into our society when no Blacks were allowed in any suburbs. And that's part of the ghettoization of people and stuff. But we don't know that because we don't talk about history with any kind of truth. So you guys have a serious, serious problem ahead. You're going to have to unearth some truth. You're going to have to look at this state, North Carolina. Some amazing things took place here. Some very violent things took place here. And some really weird stuff is happening now. So we have to look at our own space. And Claude, who was in the documentary, oh yeah, there were these people from out of state. No, they weren't from out of state. They were from right there. There was an immigrant demonstration on the ground of Central High about 4 years ago. Well, the federal government has to provide a First Amendment space. So there was a garden, and they allowed the First Amendment people who were screaming obscenities. And there were about 20 of them. And people were like, oh my God, that is so horrible. Listen to them. I said, multiply it by 1,000 or so and see what you think it would sound like. So that's 4 years ago. Not in the Middle Ages where I come from, right? So yeah, it's worth it. It keeps me active. It keeps me thinking. It keeps me learning. And that's a good thing. Thank you.
Thank you. Abigail Hiley. How are Latinos and Hispanics impacted?
There were no Hispanics in Little Rock. This is, yeah, I think the current context of, I mean, Arkansas is right next to Texas. Now we know lots of Hispanics were in Texas. But you know, states like Arkansas keep people out. And so let me tell you who was there at Central High School at the time I was there. There were two Japanese students of Japanese descent. They were actually American. And the reason they were there was there were two concentrations for camps for Japanese people in Arkansas. So these were the leftovers from that era. So there were two Japanese boys at Central. The coming of Latinos and Hispanics was in part after the Civil Rights Bill, which allowed, because we basically had mostly an all-white immigration policy until it started changing after the Civil Rights Movement. So are you, tell me about you. Were you born here in this state?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so hey, so when did your parents come? Were they here a long time or?
They came like 16 years ago.
Okay, so it's what I think we don't understand is how the Civil Rights Movement helped everybody. It helped to change the immigration policy. It changed the status of women in the society. It was pretty amazing. We think we, you know, I'm here because I was at Central. It's called Black History. It's American history, pure and simple. But I'm willing to play the Black History game for, in order to talk about something. But that the Civil Rights Movement benefited everybody in this country, and that is what civil rights are about. They're about everybody. So we kind of mess it all up and say, it's about those people or it's about those people. But every time there is a civil rights struggle, it's about everybody. So when the girl said, if somebody was a Spanish or a Chinese, we might like them, but blacks are more different from us. I can do the Southern accent because that's where I'm from. She was full of it because she didn't have anybody who was Chinese or Spanish in that school. Now, Little Rock claims to be one of the largest Latino communities, but it's segregated like we do. And so we have blacks, we have Latinos, we have whites. I don't know how come we keep doing that. That is so boring to me. So I brought my kids up. Our house looked like the UN. I said, bring me some of all of it because I don't ever want you to grow up as bored as I was as a child. One cultural knowledge. Excuse me. Not only is it boring, but it's stupid. So when I went back to Little Rock after many weird years, and there had been more Latinos coming in, I said, thank God for the Latinos, or I would have died of boredom here, because people bring richness to us. So much richness. So sorry, I had a kid in preschool ask me, well, what about the Hispanics? And I said, I'm sorry, there weren't any, or else, you know.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
And this will be our last question. What made you want to stay at Central High despite your constant harassment?
Let me think.
I think you have to know that I have no pat answers, that every time somebody asks me a question, it's like I've never been asked that question before. So I can't just throw it out. But I'm going to get crazy here. You cannot tell me that I live in the best place in the world. You can't make me sing all these songs like we did this morning and put my hand over my heart and pledge all those things and have members of my family die in some other part of the world on behalf of this country and then say, sorry, you can't go to this school. Do you think you can do that? No, you cannot. And so when we think critically, when we think at all, and that's my admonition to young people, please think, please don't just take what, mostly grown-ups, don't tell them I said so, feed into your head. You can't do that because they do you a disservice. You get to think for yourselves. So when you do that to a person, when you tell me that, when you have all these words like freedom and justice and liberty and all that, don't tell me that I can't go to a school, please. Because I'm gonna go crazy and go anyway. Because what Du Bois says in this book is that blacks have actually done more to bring this country to start beginning the possibility of democracy, because they've always been the antithesis of democracy. And so it's kind of in your face. You talk a line, but you're not honoring that line. So in fact, that has been our role, to say, sorry, you have those concepts, I want them too. And I guess you had to have my mother, who said, nobody is superior to you. And they knew that I felt that way, and it drove them insane. And we shouldn't drive people insane when we feel good about ourselves and believe in ourselves, young women, young men, young people. People shouldn't be angry with us when we express that. So I think it's another good question. Wow. Ooh, wow, had to really come up with something on that. But that's it.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So I know I'm done, but thank you. What a wonderful group of questions. What a fabulous audience. Thank you. I appreciate it.
What do I do now?
Our program is close to ending, but before we go, we would like to thank Ms. Brown Tricky for traveling from Vancouver, Canada to be with us here in Monroe, North Carolina today. Ms. Brown Tricky, here's a token of our appreciation from the students of Monroe High School.
What is a shirt?
Thank you. I love shirts. I have a collection of t-shirts that I plan to give to the Smithsonian as what I've been given, just to show how cool I am at what I got.
We are grateful for you, Ms. Brown Tricky, and we are in awe that you chose to be here with us today at CATA. Here is a token of our appreciation. Oh, you got a shirt.
Thank you.
Two shirts.
Another.
Ms. Brown Tricky, in honor of you coming to see us today, we want to present you with this plaque on behalf of Yean County Public Schools, Monroe High School, and Central Academy of Technology and Arts.
Thank you. Do we do photos now? Where's our photographer? There she is.
The plaque reads, in appreciation to Minnie Jean Brown Tricky for her dedication to education, from the students of Monroe High and Central Academy of Technology and Arts, Monroe, North Carolina, February 4th, 2015. We wish you the very best and safe travels home. Please, everyone, stand and honor our guests one last time.
Everyone, please be seated and listen as we give other dismissal.
All Monroe High students, thank you so much for coming here to CADA today. Please exit at this time. Turn right as you leave the auditorium and head back to